the champ is here!
It's just the man!
Give me a hell yeah!
What the Rock is cooking!
To be the man, you have to be the man!
Big Bubba Pump! And you hooked up!
Coffee in the big
tank. Yeah.
Why am I on the little fucking screen? There you go.
There we go.
Now I got to work the smile.
I like it.
Well, I guess hell froze over, boys.
That's right.
Oh, man.
Oh, man. Folks, we are back with another episode of Working the Marks. And, man, let me tell you, what a weekend that was in the world of professional wrestling, man. I mean, special, special, special event. And a special, special, special return. Look in my eyes. What do you see? CM Punk back in the E.
Woo!
Fucking what an amazing way to end the show. But we'll talk about that a little bit later in the main event topic of this evening. As you know, I'm Patty Reek, and I'm the Iron Man of Working the Marks here. Woo! I'm here when some other guy doesn't want to show up. And obviously joining me, my brother from another mother, the Pitbull himself, Macho Rodriguez. Macho,
yes!
How you doing?
I'm doing good, man. I'm very excited to talk about wrestling today. There's a lot that we're going to go into. It sucks that Franny's not here today. I mean, it would have been nice to see him on the show to hear all of his negativity towards the fact that CM Punk in just 1 8-minute promo got more heat than LA Knight has gotten in a year and a half.
Yes.
Ooh, pobrecito. And we got D down there in the tiny little window. What's up, D? You look like a little fucking troll, all 5'2" of you, according to Mudge.
I'm just a midget, bro, hanging out in a little world.
Oh, no, that's a derogatory term. It's little people.
Okay, right? I'm just a little dude hanging out in a little world.
Be safe. I'm working the smile today.
He's working the smile.
But, folks, we got a little bit of news here in the wrestling business, so we're going to start off with that. Apparently, QT Marshall is leaving AEW. It's been reported by Ringside News, which, you know, we tend to get some of our news from, that QT Marshall has decided to leave AEW. He logged on to X, and he let it off with a caption that said, "Thank you, AEW." QT Marshall had basically thanked AEW. Tony Khan had written about the privilege of being there since day one and has written over 750 formats for All Elite Wrestling and always with pride. "As much as I've enjoyed being a VP, manager of talent relations, and wearing a myriad of hats, the company has changed a lot since 2019 and is heading in a different direction. And I feel that it's best that I do the same, as we only get one chance to go all in. I have officially resigned from AEW and will fulfill all my obligations by the end of 2023. He went on to thank the office, the production people, and Tony Khan. Mach, how do you feel about the departure of AEW? How do you feel about the departure of QT Marshall? And we'll kind of address a little bit more of the potential rumors of what he's going to be doing after AEW. But how do you feel about QT Marshall leaving AEW?
Well, I think it's just another indicator that people are just going to slowly leave that company little by little. I think they're seeing the success that others are having in WWE. There's been a lot of people trying their best to stop wrestlers from going over to the E, whether it's, you know, talking about your life being threatened and trying to paint people as just these super toxic workers, and they go to the other company. Yeah, they go to the other company and they're super successful. Their t-shirt sells out so much where they're absolutely just like breaking the internet. I believe that's a true quote from someone from earlier today. And I mean, honestly, I think from what I read today on the internet was that he was really upset with the fact that there's lack of story. They only care about like having great matches and they don't care about progressing stories. And that's not something he really wants to be a part of. You know, you can have a great match every week if you want to, but what's the point if there's no substance to it? So I kind of agree with that. And that kind of like, let's skip over CM Punk, that kind of leads back to Cody Rhodes. Isn't that why Cody left? Because he didn't see eye to eye with them.
Absolutely, and it makes sense that QT Marshall would leave, being that QT Marshall was, you know, at one point one of the trainers at the Nightmare Factory, which he helped co-found with Cody Rhodes. You know, it's understood that QT Marshall is still looking to continue with his wrestling career. Where he pops up, we don't know. He did do some work over in AAA for a little bit. There are some rumors, yes, of him possibly popping up in WWE, but he's being offered more of a coaching role. In NXT, which he's not necessarily interested in. He does want to continue to work while he can. Whether he ends up in NXT, time will only tell. But I will say this much. He was a guy who was wearing a bunch of hats for the company, as he did mention. He was an agent at one point. He was a trainer at one point. And he was also a talent. So
Was he there with Cody Rhodes at WrestleMania?
That I don't know. I'm not necessarily able to confirm that. But I do know for a fact that he and Cody Rhodes are pretty tight, which is kind of fueling the speculation that he would at some point end up working for WWE in some type of capacity. Mach, where do you think QT Marshall is going to end up anytime soon? Do you see him popping up in WWE, maybe NXT, or do you think that he's perhaps going to work other promotions?
Well, I mean, honestly, after finding out these past couple of weeks that there's been more and more former wrestlers coming in and working at the Performance Center and helping them out, I wouldn't be surprised if NXT is exactly where he winds up. I mean, we just found out today through his own Twitter that Lince Dorado is now a coach at the facility.
Burning so, down the house.
I mean, that's pretty cool too, to have like a pretty hot luchador from, you know, from back in the day, somebody who we know a decent amount. We know a decent amount about what the fuck. That's Mexican, bro.
You said luchador, motherfucker.
Arriba. Yeah, I mean, that's what he was. He was a part of the luchador house party. But I think that makes sense for him if he's wanting to branch out. And I know TNA's coming back and things like that. Like, he can go over there and provide substance to their stories as well. Right. Because I wouldn't be surprised if by the end of 2024. The pecking order is WWE, TNA, and then AEW. So
the way it should be.
So it's interesting because a friend to the show, a friend of mine, shout out to Anthony St. James. He's an independent wrestler out there, talent that's been out there for quite some time. A guy who works for multiple companies, had the chance to train with QT Marshall. I had nothing but a glowing review about him, and sitting under his learning tree, it definitely helped him up his game. So I can certainly see him being able to do something like that. Getting back to what you were talking about with AEW kind of being more wrestling centric, it's been reported that Tony Khan, or as some people are calling him, Antonio Kanoki, he's kind of gearing them more in a New Japan type of way, in a New Japan type of style, where it's a little bit more sports based, it's a little bit more serious. Do you think that something like that could work in America, or do you think that in America stories are still what truly drive the wrestling audience?
No, I think stories are what drive the wrestling audience. I think that's exactly what it is. I mean, you've made the comment on this podcast alone. I think you made it on the Must Love Wrestling podcast too. Like, you've seen about your 10,000 hours of wrestling. Now you need something to be invested in. I mean, the thing is, we have that. There's an app for your television, for your phone. If you want to watch Japanese style wrestling, you have the opportunity to do that. You know, we need something. There has to be a reason to watch, and you need to be able to come up with organic stories, original stories. That's what drives the people in. I mean, look at what's happening right now. We're watching a repeat of old Attitude Era stories or 1994 Clash of the Champions stories with, you know, Mini Miz over there as the AEW champion. Ooh. And nobody's invested. Nobody cares. Like, can you imagine that WWE came out today and said that Roman Reigns has a torn labrum and that he's got hip inflammation?
A little torn labrum. That
they would already be planning for the future. Okay, well, I guess we're going to have to stop right now and get the title off. Nope. You have their champion just go out there and talk about
it. Is he still tag team champion?
A little bit more on that later on, because that's certainly something in the news cycle that we will be covering very shortly here on the show. But, you know, to your point and to what I've spoken about as well, I do agree that, you know, having just a wrestling-centric program isn't enough to bring in new fans or bring back old fans. You know, what made the Attitude Era special was the fact that you had a lot of characters, a lot of larger-than-life characters. A lot of the wrestling wasn't really all that great, in my opinion. I think there was better wrestling during the New Generation, you know? And even further back, you know, I mean, you could go with WWF, you know, in 1989. WWF in 1989 was doing a lot better than NWA, but NWA had better wrestling. Nobody gave a shit, though, really. You know what I'm saying? Nope. So I think if Tony Khan wants to grow his audience, he definitely has to get a little bit more wrestling character-centric and less wrestling-centric. But I honestly don't see that happening, and I think he's going to continue to give his fans what they want, which is fine, and it's an alternative, but I don't know how that's going to fare with the networks and what they want in the long run. But that remains to be seen. A little bit of news here on Ronda Rousey. Apparently, Ronda Rousey is getting a little bit of heat with one wrestler in particular, deathmatch wrestler Effie, who wrestles for GCW, has come out and has been pretty critical about Ronda Rousey. Effie, who's known for being for his outspoken nature, didn't hold back in his critique of Ronda. During his Weekend at Effie's podcast, he didn't limit his comments to her wrestling ability alone, indicating that there might be other issues he finds problematic about Rousey's involvement in the wrestling industry. He said, and I quote, when I think of if I respect a wrestler or disrespect or don't enjoy or promote a wrestler, they only have to be three things, okay? The first is a little bit good at wrestling, just a little bit. The second is they have to believe that trans people are valid and respect and honor our trans friends and family. The third is they have to believe that Sandy Hook actually happened. If you cross off zero out of three of those, you need to leave. But Ronda Rousey is the dumbest bitch of all time. She's not good at wrestling. Ooh. She's transphobic, and she questions the reality of whether Sandy Hook happened. And I just said it anyway. Ronda Rousey, you're a big dumb bitch. Now, this is a quote from Effie, not from me. Please, Ronda Rousey or Travis Brown, do not come
back,
beat
Pat.
Me up.
Watch your back,
he said, and I quote, I got to stop talking shit, but it's been on my mind all week. And it's like, oh, well, you're transphobic and you don't believe Sandy Hook happened. You're really bad at wrestling and you've never had a good wrestling match. And here we are just like, let's rehire her for another company. He said, he went on to say, WCW Junior is looking great right now. The new WCW, it's fantastic. What a fucking future for professional wrestling we're creating right now. Wow. Certainly quite a lot from Effie, a guy who doesn't shy away from speaking his mind, and certainly one of the toughest guys you've ever seen if you've ever watched one of his matches. Mach, a whole heck of a lot to say. Obviously, you and I, out of, you know, the triumvirate or the four of us on the show, we're two of the big Ronda Rousey fans. We're people that put Ronda Rousey over. How are you processing these comments, and what do you make of it?
Well, after you reading it from beginning to end, I have to agree. I think it feels like a work. But to be quite honest, yeah, because there's no way that this dude would say stuff like that about Ronda Rousey and mean it, especially with knowing how fucking big Travis Brown is. Like, that's... This is a man saying this about a woman. You just called someone's wife a dumb bitch. I just can't believe that it's true. I just don't believe it's true. Travis Brown has knocked out people for less in UFC. So let's be calm when we say things like this. As for the transphobia or whether Sandy Hook happened or not, I mean, listen, I'm not going to condone any of that stuff. What I will say is that what I said to you before we started the show, I don't remember her ever saying anything like that. And I'm one of like her few fans that have actually traveled to go meet her. I've read her book. I pre-ordered her second book.
Love's in the air.
I've just never heard her say anything like that. I tried to Google that stuff, like Ronda Rousey makes transphobic comments. I have nothing come up. So I don't know. That's a pretty harsh thing, especially in 2023, to put out there about people, because that can get people canceled nowadays. You know what I mean? So I would have to imagine that it's kind of a work. I mean, Shayna Baszler is a lesbian. That's her best friend. I mean, I can't imagine that, like, that she feels that way about transphobic people, and then she would just be so happy to be working, you know, and having a relationship with someone like her. Isn't Jessie Duke, isn't she a lesbian as well? Like she's a part of the community.
Yeah, but Mach, though, if they're talking about if they're talking about transgender, they're not talking about lesbians or gays. They're talking about women who turn into men.
It is an entirely different thing.
No, I understand that, but I'm saying it's all part of the LGBTQIA. So I mean, it's not like they're. I mean, if she's saying she leans one way and not towards the other, I don't know. I mean, people are people, man. Let them be whatever they want to be. You know.
I mean, she probably maybe if anything, she probably disagreed with them fighting in the UFC or something like that. Like, you know, transgender men fighting, you know, transgender women fighting, you know, women. You know, maybe that's what she probably said. Maybe once. Who knows?
See, this is one of those things where I feel like we latch onto things. Like, was it about that transphobic that transgender?
Probably
fought in the UFC and then broke that woman's face.
Yep, cracked the skull.
Because when that happened, there was a lot of people that had negative comments to make about it because, you know, they felt a certain way. But I don't remember her
saying anything about it though. But I mean, that's the only thing I'm saying.
I remember Joe Rogan having lots to say about it.
Here's the thing about that. I think obviously she hasn't said anything publicly because it's not out there, but people do talk while they're in the locker room, and I think that perhaps at some point that might have come up, and Rhonda might have expressed her thoughts about those things, which isn't entirely supernatural. Again. People are entitled to believe what they want to believe in, folks. It's America. You know what I'm saying? It's a free country. You know, my freedom begins where other people's freedom ends, you know, and vice versa. I mean, that's just kind of the way it goes. For me, you know, what I think about her comments is completely subjective. That's whatever. You know what I'm saying? I feel the way I feel. Other people are going to feel the way they're going to feel. But to me,
you can't get mad at opinions, bro. You can't get mad at opinions.
It was specifically about Fallon Fox. That was her comment.
Okay, it was specifically about Fallon. I mean, I think at the end of the day, women are gonna feel differently about that. I think that men, and we as men, aren't gonna understand how women perceive that. So I think that, you know, obviously women are entitled to feel how they want to feel about that. I'd also like to preface this by saying that. We at Working the Marks do not condone any of these comments whatsoever.
No.
This is not something we fall in line with.
Okay? I condone opinions.
I believe that people are entitled to believe in what they want to believe in, but we personally do not agree with any of what Effie is alleging that Rhonda has said. That being said, I got to think that this is a work too, man. I got to kind of lean towards that because to me, it seems like Rhonda's doing the rounds on the indies, right? Rhonda, as we've spoken about much, she's kind of doing her Cody thing right now, like when Cody left WWE and kind of went and worked all these different companies. Effie is a pretty prominent name on the indies. Mm-hmm. He is an effeminate deathmatch wrestler. I mean, that is pretty diverse. You know what I mean? You don't really see Rhonda doing something like that. You never know, though, D. You never know. I mean, did you ever think David Arquette would be in a death match? No. You know what I'm saying? So
touché.
You can't really rule anything out when it comes to this. But I got to think, given the GCW crowd, given the indie crowd, which is very left-leaning, right, which is very socially conscious, you got to think that Effie is trying to build Rhonda up as a heel. Because, look, all these fans will go and come on these shows and do all this stuff and talk all this hard shit about whether Rhonda could wrestle or Rhonda can't. But none of these people are ever going to say it to her, right? Nope. They're all gonna cheer as soon as Bad Reputation comes on at any indie because they're going to be surprised that a star's there, right?
Exactly. But a WrestleMania main eventer.
Exactly. But I think if you're trying to promote and you're trying to hype up a potential matchup between Effie and Ronda Rousey, I think this is a really great way to do that and to piss off that crowd and to make Ronda the heel. So, whether that happens or not remains to be seen, but this is certainly an interesting story and something that I think we're going to be keeping our eyes on pretty soon.
Yeah. I mean, the one thing I also want to touch on, since we talked about all like the, you know, the harsh parts of his comments, what I'd like to touch on is can someone please, whether you're in like we have some people watching the show, can someone please find me an Effie match that is as good as the WrestleMania match with Kurt Angle, Triple H, and Stephanie?
Not gonna happen.
Can someone find me an Effie match that's as good as the Survivor Series match with Charlotte?
Never gonna happen.
How about even the Sasha Banks match?
Never gonna happen.
Or the Bayley match on Raw. I mean, he says on here that she has to be
Sweet cheeks.
She's not even a little bit good at wrestling. She's really performed well. Can someone find me a good Nia Jax match that didn't have Ronda Rousey involved? Because the last good Nia Jax match, Ronda Rousey was in there with her. Go back and watch that match. I don't know if it was the two of them are just so bad that they were able to work a good
talking
match
about
together.
Hot Mama.
I don't know. Go ahead.
Oh no! I was just gonna kind of segue into you know what you were saying there, but I think that you know where do you think that this negative reputation for Ronda not being a good wrestler comes from?
I think it's from the same people that are of the mindset that feel like she didn't pay her dues, that she came in from the UFC. They decided to put her directly into a WrestleMania like spotlight. She had the year before with The Rock, Triple H, and Stephanie. And then the following year, she had, you know, the Olympic hero as her tag champion, and she stole the entire show. And then she gets the main event at WrestleMania. She just kind of gets pushed in because they used her name instead of being like, you know, let her just work her way up. That's what they had to do. And I think a lot of people are bitter and angry at that. They wanted her to pay her dues and start from the bottom, just like Kurt did, you know, working Sunday Night Heat against Val Venus. Like, that's what they wanted her to do. That's why people love Kurt Angle. Yeah.
Well, I think they're two entirely separate situations. I mean, Kurt Angle was an Olympic gold medalist, no doubt. That's a very, very huge accomplishment, which, by the way,
yeah.
I don't know if you know or not, he won with a broken freaking neck. And... You know, I mean, amateur wrestling back in 1996 didn't really get the exposure that UFC got when Ronda came along. Ronda was also the first female, along with Liz Caramucci, to main event a UFC pay-per-view, okay? Yeah. And she was the first ever UFC women's MMA match. She was a part of that. So, I mean, Ronda's a trailblazer for MMA. And you know, in that industry, and she's a pay-per-view draw. So I think the fact that she had that working for her created a different scenario than, let's say, Kurtz, who people didn't really know outside of people who really watched amateur wrestling. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I mean, look, the NCAA heavyweight champion for freestyle wrestling could walk down the street. Nobody's going to know who he is. But Conor McGregor walks down the street. Everybody's going to know who he is. You know what I mean?
So it's, I have to push back on that.
What do you mean?
Everybody knows who Bo Nickel is. Three-time NCAA champion for Penn State. He might be.
No, I'm talking about right now. Right now, the current.
Yeah, that happened 2019.
No. I'm talking about 2023, dude. I'm talking about coming up or 2022. Bo Nickel's a UFC fighter. You know what I'm saying? People know him from UFC. The point that I'm trying to illustrate is that amateur wrestling is a little bit more of a niche thing than, let's say, UFC. Amateur wrestling is for fans of amateur wrestling, for scouts, for people who are either scouting for the UFC or for WWE for the Next in Line program. What I'm trying to demonstrate is that it's two different scenarios because Ronda was already an established pay-per-view draw.
Yeah.
Kurt Angle was not in that position. I do agree, though, that there is some resentment with the whole paying her dues thing. But, I mean, she did pay her dues. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, she certainly was afforded the luxury of having people help her, agent her, and bring her along the way. But you certainly can't take away the fact that she latched onto it naturally. But, I mean, that's just kind of what exists with her, I think.
No, I agree. But there's also this lack of respect for people who have done it first. You know what I mean? Like, if it's not for her, like, remember, Dana White was very clear. Women's MMA will never be a thing in the UFC. She changed his mind. He put them in the main event. She was the biggest draw. Even today, we have better fighters than her out there. The GOAT, Amanda Nunes. She didn't draw Ronda's pay-per-view numbers. Gina Carano didn't draw these pay-per-view numbers before her. This is what Ronda did. She got women to the spot that they need to be in. So now we look at them and we're like, wow, these women are amazing. Look at the way we're talking about Amanda Nunes now. When Amanda Nunes was out there, she wasn't just pound for pound the number one female fighter in the world. She was considered top 10 for men and women. That's how fucking amazing she was. Do you think that she gets that spotlight without Ronda Rousey? No.
Chris Cyborg, too. Chris Cyborg and Gina Carano were both.
Exactly. You know, big,
they were like two of the legit underground women's fighting stars, and they never even achieved the fame that Ronda got or until Holly much later Holm. In their career. Holly Holm, that's was another a one, too.
Boxing champion who needed to fight Ronda for so people could take her seriously in mixed martial arts. Amanda Nunes knew it too. She knew it too when she had to get that Ronda fight. That was the fight that would get everybody's eyes on her. You know what I mean? Like, it was.
What are they doing now? Nothing.
Well, Amanda Nunes.
What's Ronda? What's Ronda doing?
A double champion. So yeah,
let Ronda find out.
They're living pretty comfortably. Yeah, that's what they're doing.
They're fine.
They're not recording work in the marks right now. Okay, that's what they're doing.
Yeah, I mean, when I look at Ron, like, and I think that people just don't. I don't understand. They just don't have respect for stuff like that. This isn't a Nikki Bella situation where you've literally done the most minimalist stuff for professional wrestling ever, and then you're complaining and bitching and moaning that you're not being taken seriously and you're not being like talked about more on television. This is more along the lines of, like, when I look at Ronda Rousey, I compare her to, like, Paige and Emma. Like, that's what got, like, the women's revolution started, their hot match in NXT. I look at what the Four Horsewomen did. Like, that's what Ronda did for mixed martial arts. So when she came in to the WWE, she came in with this hot name, and she was trying to push them along. And we've talked about this before, so I'm not going to bore everybody. Please go back in the archives and watch. But we've talked about what she tried to do for women's wrestling today in, you know, in WWE. Like, I feel like people don't give a shit about that stuff. She's not a fucking martyr. She's not sitting there. She's not, like, trying to be like, oh, you know, this is what I want and you guys should listen to me. No, she's being very clear. Like, women have not been given the opportunity that they should be given. And I want to be a part of the change of that. And she was. She was a part of the first fucking main event at WrestleMania. Like, she got them to that spot. She got the hottest superstar in the business that year, the main event of WrestleMania, just by her name alone. Becky got to main event WrestleMania.
Yeah. So yeah, I think she gets a lot of unfair flack. And if anything, I would compare her more to, like, Brock Lesnar, you know, because she was like the... She was like the first, like, legitimate woman that was out there that could, like, really truly kick ass and draw big names. Obviously, you know, Sonya Deville had a background in MMA, but, you know, nowhere near the level of Ronda Rousey and nowhere near the pay-per-view drawing ability that Ronda Rousey had. You know, and getting back to Nikki Bella, I think Nikki Bella gets a bad rap. I think she played her part in helping move things along too.
She also played her part in erasing AJ Lee. So,
well, I mean, look, I think at the end of the day, things happen in the business. Sometimes relationships don't end on the best terms. But, you know,
I agree with you.
Obviously these things happen, but I mean, we certainly can't, you know, downgrade their accomplishments.
You mean Hudson County's own AJ Lee?
Union City's own AJ Lee. Okay?
Hudson County, baby. Hudson County.
That girl shopped at Pathmark.
Yeah, she shopped at Pathmark.
What, shopping at Pathmark, AJ Lee?
She had a freaking Cuban sandwich and a guarapo over at El Artesano on Bergen Line. All right. She shopped at all the stores with all the fake clothes with Tony Hilfig and Alvin Klein. All right. She's as Union City as it gets. Okay.
Yeah.
But moving on, you had mentioned something before about Maxwell Jacob Friedman, the AEW World Champion, and it's being reported again by Ringside News that MJF sustained actual injuries during the main event of AEW Full Gear 2023. Now, despite his injuries, he isn't expected to miss any television, but he may just compete in the process. Apparently, they're reporting that he tore his labrum, and that I'm assuming that might require some kind of surgery in the immediate future. But during the Full Gear 0 Hour pre-show, MJF and Samoa Joe defeated the Guns, but, you know, retaining their tag team titles. And that was obviously before the main event that evening where he took on Jay White and defended the title there. Mm-hmm. All of that, apparently, they say took a toll on MJF. And he experienced a genuine hip injury and required repositioning after the match. That sounds pretty painful. Additionally, he suffered a torn labrum. And his sobbing promo at Full Gear really reflected how much pain he was in. Dave Meltzer, reported that MJF had this exact same tear when he was wrestling Jack Perry at Double or Nothing in 2020. He said the swelling is down on his hip, but the pain is not down. He's hurting on the hip. The shoulder is, I guess, more of the serious of the two. But the tear is worse than that one, so it's a pretty big tear. But guys work on torn labrums all the time. It was noted that MJF will still wrestle Samoa Joe at World's End on December 30th. That being said, he may also wrestle in the interim period because that injury is one that wrestlers have worked through in the past. Only time will tell what they end up doing. Mach, what are you thinking about MJF in this injury, and how do you think this affects the short-term and long-term future of All Elite Wrestling?
Okay, so I'm not a fan of Mini Miz, but for the sake of this, I'll...
Wait, time out. I got two remaining. I just want to say this segment here is brought to you by Foco Coconut Juice. Mm-hmm. Delicious coconut juice with real coconut bits. Let me. Do you hear that pop? It's like if I walked into a room and Uribe walked out. This is amazing. Let me take a sip of this.
Sounds delicious.
Oh my God, that is amazing coconut juice goodness. Mach, enlighten us, please.
Okay. So first off, I'm not a fan of Mini Miz, but what I will say is that he is definitely the face of that company. I think that they are jeopardizing their biggest star by putting him out there over and over. I know wrestlers work hurt. I get it. Brian's going to work hurt this Saturday. That's something that happens over and over and over. Edge has worked hurt in WWE. He had a torn labrum for about a year, and he worked hurt. I mean, we already know about CM Punk working hurt going up until the Rumble where he walked out. We know guys work hurt, but we don't need that to happen right now. AEW doesn't need that to happen. They're losing talent left and right. They're losing backstage people left and right. And they're in the spotlight for negative things right now. If I were them, I would definitely have him drop the title. Edge or very Roman Reigns-ish, just kind of like drop the title, say, hey, I can't work right now. Unfortunately, my injuries are too strong. I'll come back stronger than ever. And then have the title, you know, just give it to someone else like a Jay White or Samoa Joe, somebody who's established in that company for those fans. And don't jeopardize him, man. Go send him home to get better. Because if he gets seriously injured in his match with Joe, which I doubt because Samoa Joe is a fucking pro's pro. But if he gets seriously injured, what now? What then? Mm-hmm. What do you do? Yeah. That's the face of your fucking company. Not only do you ruin the potential for MJF and what he means to that company, but you also could hurt his future. You think Triple H wants to touch a guy that has that many fucking injuries and decided to work through them? This is a young guy. What's he, 27? Be smart, my guy. Just fucking go home. It's not a big deal. You're fine. There's this Continental Classic. Swerve Strickland is hot right now. Adam Page is hot right now. Jay White's hot right now. There's plenty of people you can put the title on. And it makes no sense to me. And it just shows, you know, how stupid Tony Khan can be sometimes.
Do you think that this is an instance where perhaps Tony Khan should step in and save a wrestler from himself?
Yes. I 100% agree with that. This is one of those things. I mean, you stepped out there, you stepped out into the spotlight, and you have all these major announcements that you do over and over. Like, dude, do this for your company. This is one of those things that MJF might be upset about because he might want to work through injury, because especially with how hot the CM Punk stuff is right now, and he probably feels like, you know, AEW is going to catch a lot of flack for it. But, dude, sometimes you just got to deal with that. Like, he's too important. He really is. They can't afford to lose him like that. He could be out for over a year. Look what just happened with Randy Orton. A small injury turned into a severe injury. You think AEW survives 18 months without MJF? No.
That's a tricky pickle for them. I mean, you know, honestly, you don't have to have him go out there and wrestle all the time. You know, you can have him rest until it's time to have that matchup with Samoa Joe. His promos are still just as effective as him having a match. It's something that still keeps people engaged, at least that audience specifically.
Yeah.
But you had mentioned a couple of names there of other guys that they should put the title on. And the name that jumps out to me the most is Swerve Strickland. I mean, this is a guy.
Absolutely.
He's been performing at a very, very high level. And, you know, not only that, but I mean, this is a chance for you to really kind of show your representation. You know what I mean? You're going to have an African-American champion. That's your guy right there, you know? Mm-hmm. I was just watching his podcast episode with Chris Van Vliet. It's a great episode, mm-hmm. by the way. Shout out to Chris Van Vliet, one of the best interviewers out there. Shout out to Swerve Strickland. And Swerve Strickland, man, I mean, just listening to him talk, listening to how he's willing to learn, you know, sitting under HBK's learning tree, you know, studying tape with Shawn Michaels, you know, just having that opportunity to do that and then learning from it. You know, that really shows a lot of maturity far beyond his years. Would Swerve Strickland be a guy that you would put the title on, or would it be somebody else?
Nah, fuck that. It would definitely be Swerve. You know, we've been talking about Swerve for a couple mm-hmm. of months now. We're definitely on the Swerve train before it's actually become hot to have him out there in singles matches. We talked about him being underutilized and being stuck in all these mixed matches, like these
AEW had a colored champion yet? Anybody of color?
Ricky I'm Starks, sorry, what? It was the FTW.
Has AEW
champion.
Had anybody of color as a champion yet?
Ricky yeah, I believe that term colored is antiquated. So please,
anybody who's not white, have they had anybody who's not white?
Okay. Yeah, Ricky Starks, right?
Yeah, that's Jade, just like Ricky Starks, yeah.
Jade Cargill, Ricky Starks, and
heavyweight champion. Heavyweight champion.
No, heavyweight head champion. No.
Head
no.
of the company.
No. He's made it very clear he it's wants to time. Be the first. And I believe that that is something he will accomplish. He will be the first. But yeah, Swerve is that guy, and he can bring over fans from the hip hop community to professional wrestling. It can expand them. In a way that only WWE does.
Will Dollar come in and help him?
Do you personally feel that he can match up promo-wise with what MJF brings to the table?
Yes.
I don't want to sound like an asshole.
I know we've been critical of MJF on this show. I know we've been critical of his shtick to some extent. But, I mean, look, we cannot deny the fact that he has a very unique connection with the audience, specifically that audience. You know what I mean?
It was said to me on a different show. I believe it was by, I think the guy's name is The Professor. It was either him or the JVL. They've actually made the comment to me that Max is generational at connecting with the fans in attendance. He's one of those guys that any arena he's in, any fandom that he's in front of, when he's in the ring, he can get them to react to him. So I'll say that he does a really good job with that. But I really feel like Patty, I really feel that the question should be, can MJF keep up with him? Because Swerve is original. He's organic. He's, when he speaks, it's different. It doesn't feel like he's cutting a promo. It feels like we're talking right now.
He's got
like it's natural. He's naturally gifted, man. And he doesn't have to. Yeah, he does work his ass off. So I don't want my next comment to sound stupid, but it feels like it's effortless to him. Like it's just mm-hmm. a natural ability to just go out there and do his thing. And I mean, yeah, I think that would be a great way. And just think about that. Put the title on him and then you continue the feud with him and Hangman Adam Page. Now you have this prominent feud for the AEW title, and it immediately eclipses whatever the hell's going on with Mini Miz and, you know, the incredible shrinking man over there with the crutches. I mean, it's.
Yeah, I think that perhaps that would be an interesting way to go. Swerve Strickland's stock has been rising for a pretty long time. But just to get back to something you had mentioned there, the term generational, I feel like that gets thrown around quite a lot nowadays. Would you consider MJF generational, or who do you consider generational in the business nowadays?
Brian.
Mm-hmm.
Brian Danielson. In that company, I would have to give it to Swerve. I think when our kids, when Judah and Arthur are hosting a podcast together in the future, they'll be talking about Swerve Strickland the way you and I talk about Sting and Shawn Michaels.
That's if they're not tag team champions somewhere. You never know.
Oh yeah, yeah, that's true. You know? So, yeah, that would be great. Yeah, yeah. Little Uriqua connection.
Will Judah turn on him and kick him through the glass?
I don't know. That's a tough one. He does have that heel in him, but you never know, yeah. Man. But Arthur's tough as nails, so you know it's not going to be easy.
He doesn't want to miss wrestling practice with a broken hand. What a freak!
What a gangster, man! Shout out to Arthur here on the show for that, man. Big shout out to Arthur for that. But I definitely think that term generational gets thrown around, and you know, getting back to Swerve. I feel like Swerve is different, you know? You watch him work, you know, he's got a different attire, he's got a different look, it's interesting. Prince Nana, to some extent, has really helped him out. Although, I think even without Prince Nana, he would still thrive. Yeah. His selling, his facials, everything that this guy does when he's in the ring, his ring positioning, his timing, everything. I mean, the guy is just fantastic every time you watch him. I mean, if I was Tony Khan and if I was in that position where, look, MJF's looking at a long time out, or at least, you know, have MJF get you to at World's End. I mean, I feel like Swerve Strickland would be the guy for them to really put the title on. But we'll see what happens between now and then. This guy's a star. He's a star. Yeah. He had one of the coolest entrances. You know what I'm saying? At the last pay-per-view that they had. Like, he has a lot of those intangibles, and more importantly, he has a connection with the audience. There's Triple H doing the trademark point along with him when he became the North American champion. Would have been interesting to see how he would have progressed in WWE, but I don't think that that's going to be the last time we see him there. Who knows?
Oh, they want him back.
I firmly believe that when the rise and fall of AEW happens, I firmly believe that Swerve versus Hangman Adam Page will be like the feud of feuds for them. That'll be the only feud that people talk about in that company, where it'll be like, wow, we got like Adam Page versus Swerve. And I wouldn't be surprised if it continues on. Like if it's years down the road where those guys are like synonymous with each other. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, certainly. But we'll be keeping an eye out on that. We'll be keeping an eye out on MJF, and hopefully he doesn't get injured between now and that matchup with Samoa Joe. But I definitely got to say, man, we got to give him some respect for working hurt, for being old school, for hanging in there, and for being tough. And that's certainly something that I will never take away from one Maxwell Jacob Friedman. Moving along, we got some sad news here.
Yeah.
Some unfortunate news pertaining to WWE Hall of Famer Sunny, aka Tammy Sitch. She had some legal issues, and she was sentenced, I believe it was yesterday, for a vehicular homicide. Apparently, Judge Karen Foxman had ruled that Tammy Lynn Sitch was guilty of all charges. When all the charges and time was added up, Tammy Lynn Sitch received a 17-year sentence in prison. She will receive credit for 566 days served so far. That will be followed by 8 years of probation. She will not serve out that time in a rehab center. This is the end, unfortunately, of a very, very tragic story, which took place on March 25th, 2022 at about 8:28 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Tammy Sitch, who did not have a valid driver's license, was driving south on US 1 near Grenada Boulevard. She didn't stop as required and was reportedly speeding, and her car collided with 75-year-old Julian Lasseter's parked vehicle. Unfortunately, Mr. Lasseter had passed away, and Tammy had also kind of caught a little bit of flack during this trial with some of her comments that she had made. One of them citing that she had received blows to the head as factors influencing her behavior. They found this argument disingenuous, pointing out that Sitch rarely, if ever, wrestled in her career. Most of her appearances were in Smoky Mountain Wrestling, where she played a managerial role in a gimmick character, never being presented as a credible wrestler. However, it's worth noting that Sitch did occasionally take bumps during matches which she was managing. I got to agree with that. I mean, I do not recall Sonny or Tammy Sitch really taking bumps. I mean, in ECW, she would get into catfights with, like, you know, Francine or whoever. Yeah. Dawn Marie and stuff like that. But that was essentially the extent of it. You never really saw her out there working any matches. All in all, to me, this is a very sad situation.
Yeah.
You know, as a young guy, when I was getting into the business, you know, I had met Tammy. I had met Chris Candido. Chris Candido was great, you know, to my cousin and I. He was just absolutely wonderful. Always wanted to share knowledge, you know, and we had a great time sitting under Chris's learning tree and hearing what he had to say. Tammy was also pretty nice with us as well, too, which was pretty shocking considering some of the things I saw Tammy do to some people while she was there. But all in all, just an absolutely horrible, sad story about a guy that, let's be honest, most of us fantasized about when we were young men growing up.
Yeah.
Mach, how do you feel about what happened with Tammy Sitch?
Well, I mean, you know, first and foremost, like, thoughts to the people affected, like, you know, that poor old woman and stuff. But I mean, it's sad. It's sad that, like, someone that we grew up watching, obviously you've had actual interactions with, that this is how they're, how it kind of ends for them. I mean, 17 years.
That's 60, that's a 67, long time. Baby, 67.
Yeah.
67.
I mean,
wow.
It's going to be one of those things, like, the prime of her life is, obviously she was very popular in her heyday. And I mean, I don't want to completely knock her because that's what's happened. Life is knocking her right now, but her downward spiral has been mind-boggling. You know, to watch where she was, to watch the fall is, it is definitely one of those things where, like, you hear about it in movies, but I don't think anyone in Hollywood or, you know, in music has fallen as far as she has in such a, like, short amount of time. Like,
true that.
It's pretty eye-opening. It's sad to see.
And it's crazy to think, I mean, because not too long ago, she was inducted into the Hall of Fame. She looked great. She seemed like she was getting her act together. She had her act together. And then, you know, unfortunately from there, things kind of took a downward turn. She had started up her OnlyFans and all this other stuff, which, you know, not anything wrong with that. I mean, it's, you know, people want to see Sonny. People want to see Sonny. And she was cashing in on it. And that's understandable. But I mean, certainly a cautionary tale, I think, to a lot of people out there, you know, and particularly people out there, you know, who perhaps might go out on the weekend, might have a couple of drinks and might decide to get behind the wheel. I mean, obviously it doesn't pay. And, you know, these types of decisions, you know, do affect other people. I mean, this poor old man is, you know, and his family are not being affected by it. And it's rather unfortunate, but certainly a sad situation to see where Sonny's at right now. Considering that, I mean, she really at one point had the world in the palm of her hand.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, she was, at one point, she was the person that you stick a tag team with if you want them to get over, whether it's the Godwins or LOD or the new LOD or whatever. And she was it. I mean, it's really crazy. The smoking guns too, right?
Yeah.
Drugs.
Yeah.
Don't do drugs.
Well, we can't. Yeah. I mean, not everybody has fallen this hard. It just really, really sucks that it's someone like her, especially because I don't want to say, yeah, I was just going to say that. Oh, man, we're not on his level, people. We're not on his level.
Big shout out to Sean Masters, a friend to the show, brother to the show. And Sean, man. I mean, Sean brings up a pretty excellent point there. I mean, you know, she was having extramarital affairs with a lot of guys in the locker room, namely one heartbreak kid, Shawn Michaels. Bret Hart as well. Bret had some sunny days. But, you know, it's just awful to see. And Chris really loved her, man. Chris really, really loved her. I mean, telling you, like, honestly, from seeing it with my own eyes, you know, he thought that the sun shined out of her ass. You know what I mean? Everything that he did for her, just the kindness that he demonstrated around her. Really, really sad, man. And again, I think, you know, just really a cautionary tale, not just to people in the wrestling business, but just in general, man. I mean, you know, you don't want to end up in this kind of situation. And, you know, being responsible when you're getting behind the wheel and you're having a couple of drinks is certainly something that I think people should really do. But sad to see what happened to Sonny for sure, man.
More people should have jobs like mine. I can literally get fired if I get a DUI.
Do you think, personal life? Do you guys think she's gonna do the whole 17, or she'll be like 10, or?
I think she'll cut a deal. I mean, I can't see her. I mean, unless she starts a prison riot, you know what I'm saying?
I really hope she's being watched though.
Yeah. I hope she's being watched, and I just hope she gets the help that she needs. We certainly wouldn't want to see this kind of result in a tragedy, you know, in any kind of way.
No.
I think it's tragic enough as it is, you know. Yeah. But yeah, definitely, you know, we would like to see her, you know, get some help, and you know, maybe this is a chance for her to possibly get her life together. And who knows? Maybe she could appeal it, depending upon how things go for her inside the big house. D, we have some news. Okay, can you break some news pertaining to one Vincent Kennedy McMahon and the sale of WWE? Apparently, there's a lawsuit that's come up here for Vince, huh?
Yes, sir. WWE UFC merger challenged in a lawsuit alleging shame sales process for a mega deal. Investors claim a WWE board member favored a merger with Endeavor's UFC to allow Vince McMahon to stay on as executive chairman of TKO Group.
Hmm.
We got here a lawsuit unsealed in the Delaware Court of Chancery on November 22nd alleges that McMahon pushed a quick sale of WWE to Endeavor chief Ari Emanuel, his close friend and longtime ally, who proposed a sweetheart deal that allowed the wrestling mogul to stay on as executive chairman of TKO Group and avoid scrutiny in connection with sexual misconduct and allegations that could have ousted him from the company. According to the complaint filed by investors, WWE board members conjured up a shame sales process designed to favor Endeavor and exclude other bidders seeking to axe McMahon, disregarding at least two all cash offers with better terms.
Interesting.
You want me to keep going, brother?
I think that's good enough. And by the way, I just want to give it up to you. I've never heard you read that much as long as I've known you. So
yeah, me neither, bro.
Listen, I'm gonna hot tag here for a second. Listen, you cocksucker. You cannot come on this show or Must Love Wrestling and comment how I say Shayna Baszler or Shayna Baszler and continue to say shame instead of sham. You cannot
whatever. Don't talk about my woman like that, man. I love Shane. Oh my God.
That's hilarious. I mean, you know, to me, this just seems like it's kind of more of the same old with Vince.
I want to know who else offered cash.
Well, there was the rumor that one snowman, which I don't have my special
effects
for a snowman. There was a rumor that the snowman had potentially submitted an offer. We don't know that for sure.
You know, he had cash.
Well, yeah, I mean, I'm sure people did bid on it. I'm sure that there was a lot of big offers, but I think ultimately, you know, this is an offer that favored, obviously, Vince McMahon and the WWE in general. I mean, and I think that merging these two companies is only going to be beneficial, mutually beneficial for these companies moving forward. So I'm not surprised at it, but I mean, you know, we'll see what happens. I mean, you know, Vince
is a big deal. They all got paid.
Well, I just think it's people questioning the integrity of the sale. It's people questioning the process, which is fair, and I can understand why.
Can't change it now.
No, certainly not. You know what I'm saying? But they will investigate it and they will look into it. And to be quite honest, I'm pretty sure this is going to result in absolutely fucking nothing, like it always does with Vince. So, yeah. I don't know. How you feel about it, Mach?
I think I'll say it again. It feels like somebody's out to get Vince. They are it feels like once a month there's something new about Vince McMahon, and now we have this too. Like,
yeah,
I go back to like the Ronda Rousey thing. Like, there's just like no respect for who he is now. If he did all of these atrocious things, like, yeah, then he deserves all this shit that's happening to him. But it actively feels like someone does not want this to go away until he goes away. That's what it feels like.
Cancel culture, brother. Cancel culture. Mm-hmm.
I mean, some people might call it that, but I mean, I do think that for a very long time, you know, particularly the Mark community has been very CM vocal Punk about is doing their... this. No, I don't think CM Punk has anything to do with that. I think that this is just an effort by the Mark community to really try and stick it to Vince or try and get Vince out of the equation, which is completely insane to me. I mean, look, you don't have to like the guy. But I mean, the guy is literally the reason why we're even doing this show and why we even have a business to talk about.
He built
and I think we'd be oblivious not to acknowledge that. You know what I'm saying? So you go ahead, D. You can hit it.
Woo!
Acknowledge
me.
Yeah! There you go. There you go. Mach, you got something to add to this?
No, just throwing up the one for Roman.
Nice, nice. Well, we'll see what happens. Roman. I just think it's more of the same old, same old. We'll see if there's any actual fire instead of just smoke this time. But to your point, I mean, if there is wrongdoing, then hey, man, I mean, it's, you know, you got to pay the piper. And it is what it is. But that remains to be seen. Moving on, we are now going to get to the segment of the program where we will be reviewing Survivor Series War Games 2023, which took place at the Allstate Arena in Chicago, Illinois.
Quick question,
this
Pat.
Past Saturday. Question. What's up?
Who invented War Games? Was it Dusty Rhodes or Arn Anderson?
Dusty Rhodes.
Dusty Rhodes?
It was Dusty, baby. You should it's know Dusty. That.
I know it's that, Dusty. But I'm just saying, somebody else said that in the chat, I mean, and they said Arn Anderson did it.
No.
It was created by... You should know that. It's created by the son of a plumber. Moving on to the Survivor Series review. We had a lot of great matches here. We had about five matches specifically. And they kicked off the show with the Women's War Games match featuring Damage Control, Io Sky, Asuka, Bayley, and Kairi Sane taking on the team of Bianca Belair, Becky Lynch, Charlotte Flair, and Shotzi. Mach, I'm going to hand it over to you. We're going to go with you first. I mean, you've been going first this entire time, but how did you feel about the Women's War Games match? Give me your thoughts on it.
5 out of 5 empanadas. This match was perfect. There was no wasted movements from start to finish. This had a story from beginning to end. There was the Becky Lynch and Charlotte story. There was the Bayley story being the MVP of the match. There was Io's story with her selling to the crowd, almost like telling the crowd, you know you're going to get this with the trash can spot. There was multiple layers throughout this match. Not only that, it being Charlotte Flair's first War Games match and her looking like a fucking superstar as always. This was the match of the night for me. Nothing touched this match. Nothing. This was by far, this was not only was this the match of the night, this might be... Up until this moment, I thought Trish versus Becky in the steel cage was like the main, like that was the like the women's match of the year. I thought that had actually eclipsed Charlotte versus Rhea, but right now I think this is the match of the year for the ladies. I thought they killed it. Not a single one of those superstars looked bad. And what a like let's talk about how Shotzi looked in this match. There was a lot to go on. She took a lot of harsh bumps. She looked really good in this match as well. And as we heard Triple H say in the scrum after, now we can start to look at Shotzi with the rest of these women. She's no longer like a lower level talent. She's always kind of had this with her. And she's had some really harsh botches in WWE, which is kind of mirrored wrestling fans to think that she's not any good, but she, you know, she's better than Liv Morgan. I'll put it that way. And
they're both hot.
You know, I mean, yeah, Liv Morgan's just like she's like mini Miz over there in AEW. She's just like your wish version of Alexa Bliss. So anyway, I thought this match was phenomenal, man. Me and Arthur watched it 3 times. That's how much we enjoyed this match. I think I watched that Charlotte Flair moonsault over and over and over. It was beautiful. What a spot. And Becky and Charlotte's hug, man, brought a tear to my eye.
Wow.
I loved it.
I was a fan of the match. I thought it was a really good choice to kick off the show with. To your point, I think it had a lot of action in it. I think it, you know, had emotion in it. Obviously, you know, with the Becky and the Charlotte hug, I think that was like a big, big emotional moment that popped the crowd. You know, the EO trash can spot, you know, Charlotte's moonsault, you know, there was a little bit of color in the match. I think Becky got busted open at one point. So did Shotzi. Mm-hmm. You know, EO caught the brunt of Charlotte's moonsault and caught the boot across her forehead a little bit. All in all, I thought it had everything that that type of matchup should have. The physicality, the brutality, the storytelling. It just had a little bit of everything. And for me, I think it did a good job at it moving along the potential conflict, the potential turmoil and damage control with Bayley sacrificing herself to take that spear from Charlotte Flair, and which ultimately resulted in the pin with a manhandle slam off the top rope. Do you think that they're slow burning that turn with damage control a little bit too much, or do you think that they're going at just the right pace to make this effective?
I think if they're trying to stretch it out to WrestleMania for EO versus Bayley, then it's the right pace, the absolute right pace. Like maybe this was, you know, strike one for Bayley. Almost like, yeah, you lost the match, but you sacrificed yourself so that way, you know, one of the other girls didn't take the pin, you know what I mean? And I think, honestly, like, the slower the better, because as was said last week on SmackDown, Dakota Kai is, like, the leader of damage control, and she's leading from behind the scenes, so if this leads us to her being able to work again, you know, when her ACL tear gets fully healed, I think it's just an added layer, to the story. So I like the slow burn.
Yeah, I'm with you on it. I know that some people have been critical of it online. Obviously, a lot of marks are very critical about it, and they want things, you know, now. But I think that there's something to that slow burn and building up that anticipation. I'll be honest, I think this is the hottest that Damage Control's been. I think the inclusion of Asuka has made it only better, you know, and obviously just that tension brewing with Bayley and the potential turn, you know, turning Bayley face, that would be something really, really interesting to get out of this, you know, and something that at the beginning you might not have thought was possible. But yeah, certainly a matchup that had everything in it. And for me, I'm going to go with the 5 empanada rating on it to myself. I thought it was an excellent, excellent matchup that had everything that you need in a big War Games type of matchup.
Pedro Pascal would be proud.
But Pitbull, one question.
Yeah.
How many empanadas do you give Becky's backside?
What?
What are you guys, no-selling this? What's going on here? Yeah. Becky had the sweetest backside of the whole match.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to no-sell that. I'm just going to move on.
Let's gentlemen, I'm with gentlemen here.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what that sounds like. Moving on, we had the Intercontinental Championship being defended by the longest reigning Intercontinental Champion of all time, the Ring General Gunther, taking on The Miz, aka Miswald Griswold. Mach, what did you think of this one?
I thought it was a solid match. I thought this is par for the course for Gunther. He's going to go out there. He's going to give you a great in-ring performance. I thought The Miz stepped up his game a little bit. He looked like he belonged. And yeah, honestly, I love the mentioning of all the Intercontinental Championships of past, only to have Gunther stop Miz from tying Jericho's record by beating him with Jericho's finisher. I thought that was a great added element to the story.
Yeah, I did enjoy that part of it. To be quite honest, I really wasn't blown away by this match. I expected The Miz to work a little bit stiffer. I kind of wanted to see more of that strong style out of him. But I honestly kind of felt like it was a bit of a paint-by-numbers match. Gunther, obviously, is fantastic. You knew he was going to go over going into this matchup. But all in all, you know, I thought it was a decent outing by both of them, but I wasn't blown away by this. You know, I'm gonna give it 3 empanadas.
Yeah, I mean, pretty standard. Yeah, I like that. 3 empanadas. Yeah.
Certainly not really too much noteworthy in this match outside of the use of the Lion Tamer. We saw the Lion Tamer, not the Walls of Jericho, aka the New York Crab. No, mm-hmm. We saw the Lion Tamer, and I thought that was kind of cool. So moving along after that, we had Santos Escobar, who was scheduled to take on Carlito, Puerto Rico's own Carlito, taking on the replacement in the matchup after Carlito was injured, Dragon Lee. What did you think of this matchup, Mach?
Well, I love that Carlito was pulled from the match because this adds to Santos and Carlito being like head-to-head. It just adds the element to the story. If Carlito goes in there and he has to take the L right away, then it kind of, how do you continue a feud that way? I love the way WWE has fixed stuff like that. Now this match was 8 minutes long. It was a standard. I mean, I like both of these guys. I think they're exceptional. This felt more like El Dandy versus La Parca. And it was just kind of one of those really just, you know, middle of Nitro cruiserweight battles.
Yeah.
You know, I think adding Dragon Lee at the point that they added him, it didn't really give enough time. Just kind of felt like he was thrown in there, which in a way protects him as well because he just gets thrown in and Santos is displaying this new Tony Montana, you know, character. And, you know, I was looking forward to more outside interference, was hoping that Humberto and Angel Garza would actually come up and join him. So maybe we'll get that, you know, on Friday. And I would say I'd give this a good, I'd give this a 3 empanada.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. I'm going to go 3 empanadas on this one. You know, I got to agree with you with that comparison that you made as a Nitro Cruiserweight match. That's kind of what it felt like. I felt like the match with Carlito had a little bit more heat going into it. I like that they're building towards it. Obviously, I think both guys are tremendously talented. Perhaps they might have been victims of time constraints. Who knows? But Dragon Lee is a guy that I think is absolutely fantastic too. And Santos, man, the big difference for me, I've been saying this for quite some time, is that his mastery of the English language. I mean,
yes,
the way he's able to communicate and speak English so well, I think is really going to help him and going to help him get far as a star in the United States, and particularly for WWE. But certainly a match that perhaps could have gone a little bit longer. It got exactly to where they needed to get to. You put the win on Santos, and obviously you advance the story. Friday, we're probably going to see a little bit more of the fallout surrounding it. But yeah, I'm with you. 3 empanadas, not exactly the best, but not exactly the worst. So moving along, we have the main event of the evening. And that is the men's War Games matchup featuring the Judgment Day, Finn Balor, Puerto Rico's own Damian Priest, Drew McIntyre, Dominic Mysterio, and JD McDonagh taking on the team of the American Nightmare, Cody Rhodes, Seth freaking Rollins, The Viper, Randy Orton, main event Jey Uso, and Sami Zayn. Mach, give me your thoughts on this War Games matchup.
I'm going to give this a 4¾ empanada. I just kind of feel like the beginning of the match was really slow. I felt like I wasn't really invested in the beginning. Like I was excited for it. I felt like it was more so get us to Randy. That's what it felt like. And the reason I'm knocking it a 4¼ is because I am tired. I am tired of the fucking false cash in thing. It's not a story that I'm enjoying. So I think we're allowed as wrestling fans to not enjoy certain things about pro wrestling. I'm not enjoying the fact that that they're using it as like a prop, the way they're using it, that like every fucking week he's gonna get like a failed attempt. You know, it's just like, God, you know, not that I want him to win, you know, not that I'm like biased at all, but you know, I definitely want it to matter. I want the Money in the Bank to actually matter. So it's one of those things. Heart of the City with
This is amazing. This is amazing.
This is great. We need to fucking
Wow. I love it. Shout out to Juan Sterba. Juan, you know what? You're a work in the marks top guy. We just put you over.
Yeah, absolutely. This is amazing, man. This is great.
Wow.
This is awesome.
Unbelievable. This is what a lyricist.
I love this, man. Yo, D, you gotta pin this, man. This is amazing. We gotta put this in this has gotta go to our Instagram too, man. This is awesome.
This is amazing.
Man, Juan Sterba. Look at you. I'm giving you a clap.
Yeah, we gotta give him a pop though.
This is awesome.
Oh man.
Thank you for the love, bro.
This is great, man. This is great. And shout out to our other top guy, Timothy Brown, who's not with us tonight as well. Wow. I love it. what a lyricist.
Bro, I'm digging this. This is amazing.
I'm digging this. But certainly I dug the match. I'm gonna give it 5 empanadas. I think it was on par with the women's match in a lot of ways. But I do understand why you'd like the women's match a little bit more. It did start off a little bit slow. Obviously, you know, you have the backstage vignettes with, is Randy coming? He's not coming. He's not answering. Where's Randy? Nobody's seen him. Oh, my God. It's going to be 5-on-4. They went out there. I thought everybody performed really, really well. And to your point, I get what you're saying about the failed cash-in. It is a little... You do it so many times where it kind of loses its punch. It's a little lackluster. Oh man,
oh, gracias, Argentina,
de Argentina, gracias, boludo, gracias, gracias, muchas gracias, de Argentina.
Gracias, papi. That's awesome.
Todo amor para todos los latinoamericanos aquí de nosotros aquí de working the marks.
Yeah, man.
D, we gotta get subtitles next time, bro. You know, we gotta get subtitles so you can understand what we're saying. But yeah, man, you know, I dug it. I definitely dug it. To me, the standout, I've been putting this guy over for weeks here, man, but Sami Zayn, what a connection he has with the audience. I mean, as soon as he got in there, everybody was into everything that he was doing. Mm. They were just, everything he did had fire, had heat. I mean, I love his version of a babyface right now. And I love how unconventional it is. And I love how he just rallies people behind him. Very reminiscent of Bryan Danielson in a lot of ways with the way, you know, Bryan Danielson is as a baby face and how he kind of has that bond with the audience. But I thought Sammy was fantastic. I love the RKO off the top of the cage. The timing off of that was fantastic. JD McDonough, man. I mean,
What a talented guy. That's my MVP of the match. I mean, what that a was talented MVP. Guy. I thought JD looked phenomenal. This was another one where it felt Big like head. WWE did a really great job, like just like they did in the women's match by showcasing Shotzi. I thought this match showcased JD and everybody worked really well with him. I mean,
had to work around his head.
Definitely, he looked really good in the match itself. Yeah, Sammy right now is. He's on another level in what he's doing. It looks like he slowed it down, or let's put it this way. It more so looks like everything is slowed down around him. And it just looks like it looks utterly perfect. It looks like a quarterback who just finally got the playbook and he's just like dropping dots everywhere. There's nothing Sammy is doing that has been that you can take anything negative away from what he's doing. He looks great right now, man. He looks great. And I got to be honest, I'm a big like Kevin Owens fan, and I did not expect Sammy to look better leaving KO or them splitting them up. Like, I'm enjoying the Grayson Waller, Austin Theory, and Kevin Owens feud. I enjoy that. I like all three guys. Austin Theory on the lower end of that. But right now, Sammy looks great. And ever since this dude made that comment that he's a world heavyweight championship caliber superstar, it's almost like he believes his own hype, and you kind of have to believe your own hype in professional wrestling. And he looks phenomenal, man. He looks absolutely phenomenal.
I agree. I think he almost willed it into existence, you know?
Yeah.
And you know, getting back to JD McDonagh, I would like to give JD McDonagh the Rodney Dangerfield No Respect Award. I feel like he's a guy that gets no respect. And he should get more respect, man, because the guy is a really, really talented dude. He's making the most of his opportunities. I do think that there was a little bit of an inconsistency with his character, particularly from the NXT character to the main roster. NXT was pretty ruthless. He was very underhanded, evil kind of dude. And then all of a sudden he comes up to the main roster and he's kind of like Sami Zayn with the Bloodline type of deal. You know what I mean? But oddly enough, it's really worked out in his favor. And I think he's one of the guys that's certainly kind of shining in that group right now. But I thought it was a cool way. And you know, getting back to what you were saying about the failed cash in, I thought it was a good way to bring out Randy to get that big pop, huge pop. Randy was huge. Randy was just brolic, dude. I mean, he looked amazing, yoked, as the kids say these days. He looked amazing. Randy came in, didn't skip a beat, comes in, you know, like a house of fire, trademark power slams. I mean, just does the hits, Randy Orton's greatest hits. And, you know, look like he hasn't skipped a beat at all. I mean, like the guy is just, I think when it's all said and done, and I think now, I think, you know, in retrospect, we appreciate him a lot, but I think when it's all said and done and Randy decides to hang it up, you know, people are going to look back at Randy as genuinely one of the greatest of all time. I know some years back, JR caught some flack for saying that, you know, Randy Orton was better than Kenny Omega. I don't really disagree with that. You know what I mean? I don't disagree with that assessment. And no offense to Kenny. Kenny's a fantastic wrestler in his own right. But Randy Orton is just next level. I mean, just the way this guy is, his professionalism, you know, the way that he came back so muscular, just looking the way he did. I thought he was fantastic. I love the end of the match. I thought it was great babyface heat. You know, everybody hit their big stuff, you know, and then, you know, Priest taking the pin, who was the self-appointed leader of the match. Obviously, they addressed that on Monday Night Raw. Where that goes, we don't know just yet, because we did see Rhea kind of give that devilish grin. We don't know what that's going to mean in the future. But, you know, Drew McIntyre then at the end of the match stormed out. And obviously the rest of the baby faces stayed in the ring, or the baby faces, excuse me, stayed in the ring and celebrated. And now the pay-per-view is about to be done, or the PLE, excuse me, is about to be done. You see the credits, the sign out on the bottom there. Everybody's kind of, you know, either celebrating the fact that CM Punk didn't show up, or people are really bummed out about the fact that CM Punk didn't show up. And as they're zooming out and you're getting that fishbowl shot of the arena, you hear the static and Cult of Personality comes on the sound system there in that arena, and the place erupted. And I know the term Road Warrior pop gets thrown around a lot too, but that was a legit Road Warrior pop. And that leads us to our main event topic here on Working the Marks tonight, which is CM Punk's improbable return, and pretty probable, at least in our opinion, CM Punk's return to the WWE. I mean, it for me personally, it was kind of one of those things where, like, I had to kind of, you hear the music, you see it, you see the graphic, you're like, oh my God, wow, holy shit. I mean, I'm pretty sure even the biggest of wrestling fans, or even, you know, the most indifferent people to wrestling, I'm pretty sure they all walked out. There you go. We're going to get sued, but, you know, I mean, when that music hit, man, and he came out and he walked out, it was like, oh shit, it's really him. And the crowd was just ballistic. I mean, and never mind the fact that he was in Chicago. I mean, people all around the world that were watching it went nuts. And I got to say, got to give credit to Triple H for this, man, for just literally leaving it for the absolute last minute of the show. Having Punk, you know, kind of take in that Chicago crowd, you know, look at the ring with a smile and just absorb all of it and leave the fans with a cliffhanger. Mach, give me your thoughts about CM Punk's triumphant return to WWE after 10 years away.
Well, he's home. That's my first reaction is he's home. He is where he belonged. After watching him in AEW for the past couple of years, it was clear that he did not mesh well with that group. You kind of had to have the indie mindset, and he's bigger than the indie mindset. Guys like Bryan Danielson work in AEW because of he's from the indie background. He never really changed it. He wrote about it in his book. He talks about what he believes WWE is. But getting back to like CM Punk to right now, I think this is perfect. This is exactly what makes sense. He's the biggest wrestling name since Stone Cold Steve Austin. That he is polar. He's global. As he said it, there were people in Saudi Arabia chanting CM Punk. Let's think about that for a second. He hasn't been a part of a single Saudi show. And there were people in Saudi Arabia chanting CM Punk during matches. This guy is a global superstar. He's more to the business than we ever imagined. It's clear that there's a lot of negativity towards him on the internet. I saw somebody take his first t-shirt from AEW. They put it, I'll share it in our chat later, and they burned it like a jersey. Like they put lighter fluid on it and burned it. Like, me cago en la madre porque carajo. I don't even know why you would do something. I'm not burning any of my fucking shirts.
Yeah, is this disco?
I don't know. I mean, when I'm just thinking like when I watched CM Punk come out when he cut the promo the next night, I thought it was perfect. And I just want to say before I let you go, Pap, because I know this is the end of the show here. This is how you bury a company. Right here, no selling, not a single reference, not a single nod. And I saw some idiot who calls himself Wrestling Mark on Twitter say, oh, it's all the NDAs. No, pendejo, there's no NDAs. They didn't work that in there. You can't disparage this company. Shut the fuck up. You could say whatever you want to say. Like, he could have said anything, and they decided, you know what, that company's not big enough to be mentioned on this show. And that is a Triple H thing. I'm sure Triple H said, hey, you're going to come in here. Fuck that company.
Tranquilo,
you
don't
need people, to talk about that. Let's just talk. Like, just go out here. Let's, you know, let's enamor yourself to the fans. Let's remind them who you are. Let's remind them that you're the best in this ring, the best on the microphone, the best in commentary. They stuck to a lot of his old shtick, and it worked. The commentary comment is what got the pop go. That's what got the pop going. He looks great. It looks like he beefed up a little bit too. So that could be a good thing too. I'm excited for what's to happen. I'm a little disappointed, but at the same time excited that Nakamura picked Cody. I kind of wanted Nakamura and CM Punk, but I'm sure we'll get something in the future. I was hoping that maybe it was going to be Dirty Dom and CM Punk because of Dirty Dom posting that gif of him getting beat up by Mickey Gall. But which is such a great heel tactic. Like, that kid is brilliant.
Talk about long-term storytelling. I mean, like, you know, I think it was Ray in the thick of his feud with Dom who had posted something about him and Dom, and CM Punk had commented, "I've wanted to punch this kid in the face for 13 years." I thought that was hilarious, and that was why he was still employed with AEW. But yeah, I mean, if there's anybody that could take that young punk and show him a lesson, it's certainly CM Punk, who doesn't take any shit from anybody.
He introduced the world to Darby.
Yeah, I mean he. I mean, look, you know, I'm not gonna sit here and say that I enjoyed all his stuff in AEW. I didn't, I'll be honest. But as far as it goes with being a big star and going there and providing his star power and doing things to help, you know, introduce younger talent to people, I think he did do that a lot for them.
Eddie Kingston said it.
And I'm not gonna say that, like, you know, I'm not gonna shit on his work in AEW because I'm not gonna do that, but I will say that for me personally, it's not so much that I didn't like it. It's that I always looked at it and thought to myself, you don't belong there. You belong in WWE. You belong in the big time. You're I can vouch for
that.
Fish.
You have been saying that since after his debut, that he does not belong there.
He doesn't. He doesn't.
Yeah.
He doesn't. He's a fucking megalodon in a fish tank. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, it just, it makes no sense. It makes no sense. But I understand that, you know, that's the opportunity that was given to him. That's where the money was, you know, and obviously at the end of the day, which, you know, he did say at the end, you know, he's there not to make friends. He's there to make money. Getting back to what you said about him, you know, not giving AEW any recognition or not mentioning it whatsoever. Apathy is stronger than hate. You know what I'm saying? When you completely ignore something and don't pay any attention to it, that burns a lot more than just being hateful and going on this rant. Now, at some point in time, you got to think, especially with the little seeds that they're planting, right? Him mentioning a certain wise man, his, you know, Seth Rollins, obviously, with him behaving the way he did, flipping him off at the end of Survivor Series. You know, you've seen all the fan videos that have gotten out there. You got to think that there's going to be a feud with him and Seth Rollins at some point, because to me, I think they've been trying to shoot this angle since Punk was on backstage. So at some point, you got to think we're going to get this. But what I really enjoyed about this promo was, like, and look, a lot of people shat on it. A lot of marks shat on it. Oh, it was this and that. It was an AEW promo. It was this. It was that. Blah, 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 blah. Listen, man, he had you glued to the fucking TV. You were watching everything that he was saying. And at the end of the day, the dude knows how to do that. You can hate him, you can love him, but you can't stop watching him. And that's what he's really, really great at. And I thought that it was a great CM Punk promo. I mean, from the hour of 10:50 p.m. Eastern Standard Time to 11 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, my name was not Patrick or Patty. It was Mark, okay?
Yeah.
Because I was fucking sitting in front of that TV, marking out and watching this dude do his thing. And let me tell you something. When it comes to doing his thing, nobody does it better than him. Nobody does it better than him. Because love him or hate him, you can't stop fucking talking about him. You know what I'm saying? So I thought it was excellent. I thought it was a great way to reintroduce himself to the crowd, reintroduce himself to kids like, you know, like Arthur, like Judah, you know, who had seen bits and pieces of him, but, you know, never actually got to experience him in WWE. And now they're having that opportunity to do it. I mean, I know that there's going to be a lot of negative comments. I know there's people calling him a hypocrite and all this stuff. Well, guess what? You got fucking worked. Okay? You got fucking worked. Sorry that you got all up in your feelings because shit didn't work out for him in AEW. And now he decided to go somewhere else where his star will shine brighter.
Brighter.
It will shine brighter than AEW. And he will make more money and he will set more records. I mean, let's just take a look here real quick at some of these Survivor Series numbers. Because, I mean, you want to talk about record breaking. I mean, you know, and I know a lot of people are going to say this is gimmick, but let me tell you something. WWE has nothing to lose or nothing to gain by making up fake numbers. You know, this isn't this isn't like a fake attendance for a stadium show. These are legitimate numbers. CM Punk alone, just in the 48 hours since he came back, generated, I mean, crazy, crazy metrics, okay? This Survivor Series was the most viewed Survivor Series of all time. It was the largest gate in Survivor Series history. It also set a Survivor Series merchandise sales record. CM Punk's return was the most social moment in WWE history. Okay? And the sponsorship revenue was up 24% from 2022. I mean, this is all incredibly believable. And let's not forget the biggest cherry on top, the double point. With Triple H and CM Punk with the caption, I guess, hell's pretty warm right now. What was it? It's pretty cold in hell, I think it was. What was the caption?
Hell froze over. I guess hell froze over.
I guess hell froze over. So, you know.
Add one more stat to that. Since
that's
since
the most liked picture, right?
Yeah. I want to add one more stat to that since Franny couldn't be here tonight because he was on a hot date. I want to do this for you. Since Saturday, CM Punk is the lead. He has the hottest shirt in WWE shop. It's the number one selling shirt in WWE shop, as announced today. He is already number one in merch sales with one fucking shirt.
I'm not surprised. I am not insane, bro. I'm not surprised.
if I could just say one thing on here, because I don't want to forget about it, because Patty, you actually said this on this show a while back. I mean, holy shit, Billy. Billy Body called every... It's almost like he had a premonition. He called everything that happened at Survivor Series. If you remember correctly, the report that you had said on the show, they were going to give him a t-shirt, they were going to show him to the crowd, and go on from there. And it worked exactly that way.
Well, he had reported the Nakamura match, actually. That was what was initially reported. But yes, to your point, yeah. Yeah, he did mention that. And look, Billy's the most reliable guy out there. People could love him. People mm-hmm. could hate him. People could feel however they want to feel about him. Dirty Sheets always gets it right. Not Meltzer, not Alvarez, not any of these guys. Again, you don't have to like what the guy says, but no, when it comes Meltzer's to wrestling news,
shambles right now.
The guy's spot on. Alvarez, they're definitely in their feelings, and they're definitely upset because, I mean, these are very pro AEW guys. These are guys that CM Punk confronted about the bullshit that they were reporting, trying to fuck him and the company over, you know, when they were trying to sell a big main event. And for what? Why? Because you want to impress the Rancho Cucamonga boys? You know, I don't know, man. Look, at the end of the day, if you're going to be a business, man, you can't have those emotions involved. And I think that factor is why CM Punk is going to work in WWE this time around. It's reported that he signed a 3-year deal with the company. And leading up to him being fired from AEW, there's actually some news that had came out recently in regards to CM Punk's dismissal from the company. Much. You had mentioned that news earlier. What exactly is that news that was reported?
So it is being reported that the Bryan Danielson headed up AEW disciplinary's committee that ultimately led to the decision of terminating CM Punk from his contract. And I just want to be clear about this. In regards to the situation with Bryan Danielson, Danielson was just a glorified messenger. He shouldn't take the blame here. If anything, this would be very difficult for him, being that he has a relationship with CM Punk himself. This is just another situation of Tony Khan lacking the balls. He's the boss, and he was there at Wembley. He is the disciplinary committee, and he's just using Brian as a scapegoat here. Honestly, I feel bad for Brian because he'll get the heat for this by the internet wrestling community, but anybody who's too short-sighted to see that Tony Khan is the real problem right now, they're just going to look for somebody to blame. And it's really telling to me that news like this would break, especially after Brian tweeted what he tweeted today or yesterday about how sometimes decisions aren't made. I'll read his tweet aloud here. See what he says here. He said, "My dad always told me the right thing is often the hardest thing to do. It won't always make the most money. It won't always be the most popular, but it's still the right thing. Hashtag AEW with a heart." I think Brian is just a company man. He really enjoys the company he's working for. I don't think he has any fucking sway.
He's getting a fat check for doing nothing.
Yeah. You're shut your dumb ass up.
I don't think there's anything malicious behind, you know, what it is or what Brian was, I guess, appointed to do. I also think that Brian had the awareness to look at what was going on with CM Punk, was going on in the company. And I think he looked at it and he realized that Punk was looking for a way out, because it's been reported that Punk tried to leave in 2023, at the beginning of 2023. There was the infamous incident with Punk showing up at Monday Night Raw in Chicago, where it was reported that he had a conversation with Triple H and said hello to some people, namely The Miz as well. I mean, he wanted out. He wanted out. Yeah. I think he went to AEW. He saw what it was about, and it wasn't what he thought it was going to be. And he understood that, you know, there was more to do and there was more that he could do. The other thing too is, I mean, you know, Punk's not 20 something years old, man. Punk's in his mid 40s. You know, you're not always going to be able to be in the condition to wrestle, and you want to maximize your name and you want to maximize your chances while you have them. And I don't blame Punk for wanting to leave, but I think Bryan Danielson also saw that, recognized that, and said, hey, this is an opportunity for you know, him to get what he wanted. That being said, it still doesn't negate the fact that there are major structural issues in AEW. And there are major issues with the young talent and the veterans. And I think that there's a bit of a generational disconnect, perhaps, with certain people. I mean, look, Bryan Danielson's not like CM Punk in the sense that Bryan Danielson's going to tell somebody to go fuck themselves. I'm sure if push comes to shove, he will, but he's typically going to look for a more peaceful resolution. You know, CM Punk is not that kind of guy. He's going to tell people to go kick rocks if it calls for it. And when you have a young wrestler who has a big head, who quite frankly really isn't as good as his ego fucking tells him he is, you know, and you want to run your mouth at a veteran and you want to try and show him up on pay-per-view, you're going to deal with what you're going to deal with. But again, I think there's a lot of details that we don't know. I think there's a lot of context that perhaps we're missing. And I think that the issues in AEW certainly left to Punk's early departure. But, you know, I think it's a little unfair for them to pin it on Bryan. I think anybody who wants to blame Bryan Danielson's an asshole because that's just not the kind of guy that he is. But I think Bryan Danielson certainly was aware of the fact that Punk wanted to leave. Yeah. And I think he presented him with that opportunity to leave.
Yeah. I agree with you there. I think it's one of those things where, you know, they're looking for someone to blame. And why not blame the guy that is universally loved by wrestling fans? Because fans, like, I've seen both sides on Twitter. There are people that are angry at Bryan because Punk is now over in the other company and why couldn't they make it work? And then there's people that are super happy that Bryan did what he did, supposedly did what he did, you know? So I think it's one of those things where it's a smart play by Tony Khan. It's also a sleazy ass play. Real sleazy.
It's interesting too, because I think it was not that long ago, it might have been last week, where CM Punk had had posted something in his story. It was a quote from a boxer about how somebody who doesn't want to be involved with conflicts, you can't trust them because they'll always prefer the illusion of safety instead of just, you know, confronting an issue and talking about things. Some people might have thought that that might have been aimed at Tony Khan, and given what we've just learned now with Bryan Danielson and his involvement with the disciplinary committee, it kind of seems like it does make sense and it kind of does line up. But I mean, look, you know, at the end of the day, I personally feel like this is a huge loss for AEW. And I feel like Triple H and CM Punk have rehashed their differences and have rehashed them enough, at least for them to be able to do business together. I'm sure that Punk is very welcomed back in that locker room. He's a veteran. He's a guy that's respected. He also shouted out Union City's own AJ Lee in the promo and mentioned that she's fabulous and she sends regards. I just think that it's a better fit for him. And I think that the best of CM Punk is certainly yet to come. And I think that this build for WrestleMania is going to be an all-timer, man. And what they end up doing with it between now and then, I think is going to be really, really good, because you have a guy like Triple H who understands what he has in CM Punk and how to maximize that. So there's that infamous picture, the most liked picture in WWE social media history. Let that sink in, folks. Let that sink in, because WWE social media has been around for quite some time, okay? And that is the most liked picture in WWE social media history. So it tells you everything you need to know about it. But I'm certainly excited for it. And I'll tell you right now, I'm gonna call this now. I think at some point or another, Paul Heyman is gonna end up back with CM Punk. We're gonna see that reunion. And I think that CM Punk is gonna be the heel working a babyface Roman Reigns. I genuinely feel that is going to happen. Is,
you know, we have been thinking about this for a long time. This is one of those things. This is the best way to get Roman over as a face, because no one can work heel like Punk. He can get this to happen. Yeah. This is something that he can make work.
Would you compare him to like a 97 Shawn Michaels in that sense, where like he's that guy that could go out there, the crowd could cheer him, but at the drop of a hat, the crowd will boo him out of the building and want to kill him?
I would go a step above that. There's one guy who has that ability, who had that ability to make that happen with just one look.
That was Eddie Guerrero.
Eddie had this ability to jump from face to heel in a way that we hadn't seen before. We saw shades of it with Owen Hart. Owen was able to do that.
Roddy Piper, to some extent, was another guy.
It was one of those things, like, I would definitely put him in that category. But, like, obviously, 97 Shawn was a heel because, you know, the dirt cheats made him a heel. And then,
but Shawn could also literally at any point in time drop that shtick and do something, you know, hero-esque, something that a babyface would do, and the crowd would get right behind him immediately right there. Obviously, there's pictures of the late, great Eddie Guerrero, who we all very much miss still to this day.
We have the pleasure of watching his son kill it with the Judgment Day, so it's amazing. Oh, look at that little troll right there. I think that guy and Deer.
Deadbeat Dad.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. Deadbeat Dad. And there's the Ultimate Edition figure of Eddie Guerrero, which, by the way, is one of the nicest figures I think I've ever seen. I just think that Punk brings so many intangibles that are kind of missing in WWE, but just that ability for him to just people pay attention to him, man. Yeah. People latch on to every word. You know, he's, in my opinion, the greatest speaker of his generation.
Yeah.
You know, Bryan Danielson is obviously the best worker of that generation. AJ Styles very much in that conversation as well, too. Certainly can't take that away from the phenomenal one. But Bryan Danielson's the greatest worker of his generation. And CM Punk is undoubtedly the greatest talker of his generation. I'm excited, man. I am genuinely excited to see where this goes. And I think that this is just another coup for WWE. Another star, another weapon that they have available for them to be able to do what they're doing and for them to be able to continue to just really function at a very, very high level. So I'm very, very excited. Just one last thing here before we call it quits here. I know we're working a little overtime tonight, but there was a lot to talk about. What is one thing that you want to see out of CM Punk in this upcoming run, Mach?
Ice cream balls.
WWE.
I want him to get what he has been asking for the past 10 years.
What's that, brother? His
main event at WrestleMania.
I think
that's
he will.
That's what I want.
Fuck yeah.
I think he will. I do.
I feel like that's where a lot of his resentment came from. I feel like he's very Bret Hart-esque in the sense that certain things in professional wrestling matter to him more than money. Scott Hall said it all the time, like, Bret would rather be the world champion than be the highest paid guy in the business. And I feel like that's how CM Punk looks at the business. Obviously, being a big Bret Hart fan myself, too. Not as big as him and FTR, obviously. But when I look at Punk, I feel like that main event matters to him. And I think he probably said in his contract, if I could just kind of be like a fly on the wall, you know, or pretend to be, I'm pretty sure that he will do anything Triple H asks him to do. He'll put over anybody, but I think he definitely worked that in, like, dude, I got a main event WrestleMania, like, just night one or night two.
Perhaps, but you know what? I think at the end of the day, Triple H, I think, has the awareness to see that you kind of got to let it marinate, and you got to see where it gets to. Because you might have a main event in mind and you might have something else on the card that same night that might be hotter and might have, you know, the crowd more invested than, let's say, you know, that main event, you know what I'm saying? Or that potential main event. So, but I believe without a shadow of a doubt that if it is going to in fact be CM Punk and Seth Rollins for the title, that's going to have all the heat necessary to be the main event of night one. It really, really is. And especially with Punk's promo ability, with Rollins and the character work that he's done thus far, I feel like this is going to be, it has potential to be an all-time classic. It really, really does with the two guys involved. And I'm incredibly excited to see where they go. We could get Nakamura and Punk at some point in time, but I think we just got to enjoy it as it comes, and we got to trust in Triple H, and you know, as the kids say, we got to let him cook. And I think that Triple H is definitely going to be cooking up a mean, mean gumbo heading into WrestleMania. Marge, Oh, no, go ahead.
I was just going to say, if they ever make a movie with CM Punk, like, you know, his life story, I look forward to Pedro Pascal winning.
Yes.
You have to do a dig at the end, right? You have to dig at the end, right?
I like it. I like it. And also, I would like to say on this show, We as Puerto Ricans, Mach and I, we would like to adopt CM Punk as a part of the Puerto Rican community, being that he is married to AJ Lee, who is a Puerto Rican, and we would like to adopt Carlos Miguel Punk as a fellow Puerto Rican, as a Boricua. He has visited the island, okay? He has worked on the island, and we consider him a part of the Boricua community as well.
Will you buy him a slice of pizza from his famous pizzeria you have in Union City?
I don't know about that, but I certainly will take them to get some alcapurria, some bacalaito, and definitely some arroz con gandules and some pasteles. So.
And if anybody's asking, because he's also married to a Puerto Rican woman, we have already adopted Baron Corbin, and we have already adopted Randy Ortega, so we're good.
Yeah. Wait, you're missing one. You're missing one.
Who do we got? Zelina, who we missing?
Zelina Vegas hugging.
Zelina Vegas. What about Mateo Hardy?
Mateo Hardy. That's right. These guys. They're all Puerto Ricans. We love them all. We love them. Absolutely. Yeah, so
they're all adopted Puerto Ricans, yo. And you know, get one of
these. In terms of all of these people, we love all of these wrestlers first. But in terms of Mateo Hardy, I love his wife more than I love him, though.
Oh,
like, nice. Reba Hardy's amazing.
She's a goat, bro.
Great mom. Great mom, and she's a gothic queen. So let's leave.
She's a Mets fan though, but whatever. We'll let it slide. She's from Queens. It's all right. That makes sense then.
You know what I mean? That's all right.
Yeah, I mean, they got some boys over there too, so it's okay. Mach, before we sign off,
go ahead. Yeah, what do you mean?
No. What were we gonna say? Eddie Murphy wore what?
Eddie Murphy wore a Mets jacket in Coming to America, and he looks sick doing it, so it doesn't matter. Like, it's all good.
Hey! He also wore a Lions jacket when he was Axel Foley, and I'm pretty sure he'd be happy with how the Lions are doing now.
He looks really good wearing that Lions jacket in all the set photos from Beverly Hills Cop 4, so I'm looking forward to that coming out, too. So.
Ooh, I just want Judge Reinhold. Judge Reinhold. Is it Judge Reinhold? Yes, Judge Reinhold. I just want Judge Reinhold in it. You know, and Bronson Pinchot. You know, Ahuel! I just want to see Bronson Pinchot up in there. Yeah.
Well,
I cannot. Yeah. That would be awesome, man. That would be awesome. Mach, before we sign off here on Working the Marks, anything you want to plug, anything you want to share with our viewers here tonight?
Well, I mean, guys, if you want to continue an in-depth wrestling conversation, tomorrow night is the night that we film Must Love Wrestling. Patty, you going to be on tomorrow, or are you going to sit this one out?
I'm going to have to take a look at my schedule. I'm going to have to see. Perhaps I might get a hot tag and come in. I don't know. We'll see.
He's working the marks.
All right. Well, I'll send you the link anyway, and then you can kind of jump in if you want to and kind of fuck with me Tyler, because I'm definitely going to shred his CM Punk stuff here tomorrow. But yeah, I mean, that's pretty much it, guys. Just follow me on the TikToks if you want. It's at Macho Rodriguez, and you can follow me and hear all my comments and interact with me there. TikTok is easy to interact with people because you can DM me. And I really enjoy being a part of this show. This is I host my own wrestling podcast on Wednesday nights, but I think this is my favorite show to be a part of. I love being able to share the stage with my boy Pat, you know. Been friends since we were 13 years old, brother. I couldn't do it with anybody better. And then there's the little garden gnome in the corner there too. Like, I enjoy him too. Yeah.
Oh man. Yeah, we've been friends ever since you walked into Mr. Hearn's class with that sweet baby mullet and that t-shirt, that Sting t-shirt, and the tightest pair of jeans I ever seen on a man since the 80s. And I said, "Who's this asshole?" You said, "We're gonna fight after school." So So yeah, we've been friends. We've been brothers ever since then. And yeah, we absolutely love having you on here. We appreciate all your contributions to the show. Folks, check out Must Love Wrestling with the Canadian Rican Connection. Shit, I might make a cameo. I might get a hot tag and come in tomorrow night. Who knows? But we appreciate all the love on here, all the love on Famcast Media from Vince McFamcast, the head of Famcast Media, as well as our very own D Rotten down there. D, I can't see you in that tiny little window. Is there anything you want to plug before we sign off here?
Yeah, make sure you guys stick around and check out Front of Dungeon Podcast happening at 12:05 a.m. tonight, I guess, or tomorrow. Whatever.
Tomorrow?
In about 30 minutes, bro. With Mark with A.
With the legend? With the legend Mark Bernardo? Oh, shit.
Legend Mark Bernardo.
Shout out to the legend Mark Bernardo, man. Oh, that's Pearl OG Studios, right there.
What is he? Pearl? He calls himself Pearl Studios. I don't know. What do you call those guys that deliver food?
I don't know.
Delivery men?
I don't know. Whatever. He's the man from Pearl Studios. He's the legend. He is the fucking mayor of Jersey City, Hudson County, Mark A. Bernardo. He will be on tonight.
Yeah, yeah, man. Yeah. Big. Lots of love to Mark Bernardo. Lots of love to our fan tonight, Carlos, all the way out from out in Argentina, man. Home of the world champions out there, man.
Juan Sturba, thank you so much for the
Juan. Oh, it was I call this guy Carlos? My bad, Juan Sturba. Shout out to you, Juan. Thank you so much, man. Thank you so much, man. All shout outs to you, man.
We love it,
and we appreciate all the love. We appreciate all the support, man. Check out all the great shows that are available on Famcast Media, man. Give us a like. Give us a follow. Don't send me no DMs. Don't send me no chain letters. Don't send me no Ponzi schemes. I don't want none of that. But definitely keep checking out the shows here that we keep bringing you every single week. Hopefully we'll have the professor back with us again next week. It's been great having you, folks. Keep watching wrestling. Whatever you like, AEW, WWE, New Japan, Impact, it don't matter. Keep talking about it. Keep loving it. Keep the wheel turning, man. We're going to keep talking about it here. He's Macho Rodriguez. He's D Rotten. And I'm Patty Friggin' Rican. And every week here on Famcast Media, we are working the marks. We'll see you next time, folks. Have a great night.
Famcast Media. Bitch.